afternoon. This is a great conference. It takes a huge amount of work and an effort to organize an event like this. So to all the organizers, thank you very much. I'm glad to be here today and talk to you about the instrumentation, data acquisition, data transformation and analysis. My job with the SAFIRE team is to not only collect data from the experiment, but to collect it in such a way so that it can be used after an experiment has been done for our team to more easily see relationships between various events that are occurring during the experiment. Further to this point is to also be able to pull the data from an experiment so we can do detailed analysis on those relationships. In this data and the integrity, it is this data and the integrity of this data which is vital to quality of the work that we do. But first, I would like to talk to you about what is an experiment, how experiments were done in the past, and how the SAFIRE team does them today. An experiment is a procedure to test a concept or a hypothesis. The reasons why we do experiments is to gain insight into what causes are involved in an observed effect, which may support the hypothesis or show that the hypothesis is false. Galileo's hypothesis was that on Earth, all objects fall at the same rate. But prior to this, most people thought that the heavy ball should drop faster. Galileo found that his hypothesis was correct. But the big question became, why? Why are they dropping at the same rate? It was not until Sir Isaac Newton defined the law of gravity that scientists started to understand why the balls fell at the same rate. So as science progresses and experiments become more sophisticated, the causes of effects become more difficult to determine. This also means it is more important to conduct robust or repeatable experiments and use measurement devices capable of high degree of accuracy. It also becomes more challenging to clearly show to everyone the causes of a particular effect. I want to introduce the important concept of time in an experiment. We start off with a beaker of cold water, and we are going to heat the water one way, and then we will heat the water by another method. We need to add a stopwatch. And a thermometer. So we can see how long it takes to boil the water. Now we will add the heat. We will watch and document how long it takes the water to boil. After approximately 10 minutes, the water comes to full boil. But then I asked myself, is there a more effective and quicker way to heat the water? I had the idea that if we could use the afterburner of an American F-18, that might be a more effective method to heat the water. I discovered that, in fact, I was right. It took approximately 0.05 nanoseconds to not only heat the water, but vaporize it, and the beaker with it. I suggested to Monty that we should keep the F-18. But he was mumbling something about budget constraints. Now, back in the day, when scientists worked in the laboratory, they had to document everything manually. As experiments got more complex, it required more scientists to record and collect data. They created procedures on how to collect the data. Aligning the data to the same timeline was a challenge in the past, as it is today. Then plot the data, and finally do analysis with the data to determine the cause of the effects. So as experiments become more complex, the necessity of more sophisticated methods of measurement become vital to the success of the experiment. Let us have a look at the progress of the data acquisition, specifically in this case, capturing of what we see. This picture of the Egyptian sun was most likely created with a hammer and a chisel. In the mid-1800s, an astronomer and physicist, Warren De La Rue, designed and built the first cube photoheliograph used to photograph the sun's corona. For his time, this was a major scientific breakthrough, since up until this time, no known photographs of the sun's corona ever existed. But as we all know, advances in technology over the eons have helped humanity in many ways. And we now have, through the hard work of Lockheed Martin and NASA, the Solar Dynamic Observatory. What we are looking at is a full-disk, multi-wavelength, extreme ultraviolet image of the sun, taken by SDO on March 30th, 2010. False colors trace different gas temperatures. And these temperatures are represented in their own images. SDO light spectrometer returns this light spectra. At the top of this graph, we are looking at the SDO broad light spectrum from the sun. Below, we are looking at the actual light spectra converted to specific light wavelength peaks. Every element emits a very specific light spectral signature when it is ionized. And it is by using optical spectroscopy we can tell what elements make up the light from the sun. Or, in our case, the light is coming from sapphire. This is a sapphire plasma discharge, and the light we get. And this is an example of spectral signatures we get back from the optical spectrometer. The SAFIRE experiment is based on Monti's analysis of the electric sun model of charged plasma affecting matter of a different electrical potential. So we introduce electrical power in the form of voltage and current, then chamber pressure and plasma gas types. And when these factors are introduced into the experiment, then we measure these responses: plasma voltage and current, chamber pressure, plasma gas types, light spectra, linear probes voltages, temperature, video capture, photography. Here is a picture of phase one of SAFIRE, showing the array of many instruments we are using to acquire data. As each instrument is acquiring data, we also record video of each instrument's computer monitor. This is the mass spectroscopy. This is a screen of voltage, current, and pressure gauges. This is a screen of the light spectra. And we also conduct synchronized video recording of the changes in the SAFIRE chamber in real time. We then consolidate all the video feeds into one master video as a video recording of each experiment. This is the example of the video. It helps our team to very effectively recognize the points of interest that happened during the experiment. Let us investigate how data acquisition devices work. You have seen some of the results. Now let's take a look at what is under the hood. There is an analog digital converter at the heart of each data acquisition device. The controller connects to the data acquisition device and collects the digital data. The computer communicates with the controller, reads the controller's data, and stores the data. The data acquisition path follows from the data acquisition device through the controller into the computer, where all the data is stored. A data transformation engine takes all the data from the experiment and transforms the data into comprehensive graphical overlays. And this is to help the SAFIRE team to analyze the data, looking for causes of the effects we observe over the time. Here, we have thousands of data points of the plasma current. Now we overlay the voltage. And high pressure measurements. And high vacuum pressure measurements. And these are just a few. There are thousands and thousands of data points. But what we see is that in this region, for example, after the pressure dropped in the chamber, there is a huge spike in voltage and current. The data transformation engine allows us to zoom into these regions with extremely high resolution. And we see that both the voltage and current are discharging out in this region of the graph. What we discovered was quite profound, that during a short time, SAFIRE had an intense plasma discharge that measured over 2 million watts. What is so profound is that we limited the input power to only 1800 watts. The transformation engine allows us to zoom in and examine in extremely high detail these points of interest. It is this kind of information that helps us determine what factors need to be used in the design of experiments that Dr. Paul Anderson will present now. Thank you.